में कर दीजिए या तो पिन कर दीजिए उनको।
ठीक है, आ रही है सर, सब की आ गई, आ गई,
तो
आ गई।
डॉक्टर एस के सिंह, ये करेक्ट 11 बजे शुरू करना है या आगे पीछे करना है?
बिल्कुल करेक्ट, 11 बजे सर आप जो आवाज कर देंगे वो आ जाएंगे। डॉक्टर
ठीक है सर। प्रॉब्लम्स कहाँ कहाँ पे है?
एस के
डीबी से लाइव हो
सिंह
चुका
जी,
है। हाँ
हाँ
तो
सर, आ रही है आपकी पिक्चर। डॉक्टर डीबी सिंह जी, आप रेडी रहिए, फर्स्ट
ये
आपकी।
प्रॉब्लम कहाँ?
म्यूट
बस ठीक
म्यूट
है, हमारा सब कुछ क्लियर है ना?
डॉक्टर एस के सिंह,
हाँ यस सर,
ये म्यूट करने का जो वो है वो तो डायरेक्टली उनका रहेगा ना, होस्ट के पास ही
हाँ
सब।
हाँ हाँ ये डायरेक्ट हमारे इंजीनियर सुधीर कुमार जी म्यूट कर देंगे सबको।
ओके।
हाँ हाँ
और
ठीक है सर, अभी
सिर्फ और
स्टार्ट
उसको
होगा म्यूट कर दिया
पिन
जाएगा।
ये करते रहेंगे जो बोलेगा
हाँ
अपने से है?
हाँ हाँ हाँ
ये मेरा
बिल्कुल।
नंबर, वो प्रेजेंटेशन का कौन सा नंबर है मेरा?
आपका थर्ड नंबर है,
कितने बजे से?
बस आप सुनते रहिए, आप 10-10 मिनट में नंबर आ जाए।
ये मैं किसको अनम्यूट करता हूँ? सर किसको किसको अनम्यूट करना है? कैन यू लेट मी नो? 1 मिनट, आप पहले अनम्यूट कीजिए।
जो
डॉक्टर डॉक्टर एस के सिंह
जी सर,
डॉक्टर नौशाद खान
अनम्यूट
से
कीजिए।
बात
एस के
हुई?
सिंह सर,
हाँ बात हो गई थी, उनको मैंने बता दिया था, सुबह बात हो गई थी।
डॉक्टर
हाँ
साहब 11:59 हो गए हैं,
हाँ
तो
तो हाँ हाँ
जस्ट 11 आई विल स्टार्ट
जी बिल्कुल
एंड
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल, आप सभी का
और
स्वागत है, और मैं एक बार
ठीक
सबका स्वागत करता हूँ टेक्निकल सेशन सेकंड में। और आज के हमारे टेक्निकल सेशन सेकंड के जो चेयरमैन है, डॉक्टर एस एस गौरव, प्रोफेसर एंड हेड डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जेनेटिक्स एंड प्लांट ब्रीडिंग, सीसीएस यूनिवर्सिटी मेरठ। चेयरमैन डॉक्टर नौशाद खान, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर, सीएसए यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड टेक्नोलॉजी कानपुर। एंड रिपोर्टियर मिस्टर अभिषेक सिंह, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर जेनेटिक्स एंड प्लांट ब्रीडिंग, सीसीआरपीजी कॉलेज मुजफ्फरनगर। एंड टूडेज स्पीकर डॉक्टर डीवी सिंह, प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंटमोलॉजी, SVPUANT मेरठ। नाउ आई हैंडेड ओवर टू द सेशन टू द प्रोफेसर एंड हेड डॉक्टर एस एस गौरव सर।
थैंक यू डॉक्टर एस के सिंह जी फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू चेयर ए सेशन, एंड थैंक्स अ लॉट टू ऑल द ऑर्गेनाइजर्स एंड प्रिंसिपल ऑफ दिस कॉलेज एंड फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग सच ए वंडरफुल ई कॉन्फ्रेंस और वेबिनार। सो आई एम गोइंग टू इनिशिएट द सेकेंड टेक्निकल सेशन। इन सेकेंड टेक्निकल सेशन एज ए को चेयरमैन डॉक्टर नौशाद खान, एसोसिएट प्रोफेसर फ्रॉम सी एस यू टी कानपुर इज विद मी। डॉक्टर नौशाद खान इज हियर एंड ही हैज ज्वाइंड डॉक्टर नौशाद एंड
शायद
एज
शायद अभी नहीं जुड़े हैं।
और एज ए रिपोर्टियर मिस्टर अभिषेक सिंह, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर सी सी आर पी जी कॉलेज मुजफ्फरनगर। ही ऑलरेडी प्रेजेंट हियर एंड अवर लीड स्पीकर इज डॉक्टर डी बी सिंह। ही इज ए प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एग्रीकल्चरल एंटोमोलॉजी, सरदार वल्लभ भाई एग्रीकल्चर यूनिवर्सिटी एंड टेक्नोलॉजी मेरठ। एंड अदर देन लीड स्पीकर वी हैव टोटल 8 स्पीकर एज ए ओरल प्रेजेंटर। सो आई विल अनाउंस वन बाई वन एंड आई रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द ओरल स्पीकर दोज हैव ज्वाइन प्लीज इंश्योर दैट योर टाइम लिमिट इज मैक्सिमम 10 मिनट। ट्राई टू फिनिश योर टॉक विद इन 8 मिनट्स, सो 2 मिनट मे बी गिवेन फॉर क्वेश्चन आंसर सेशन। सो नाउ आई रिक्वेस्ट अवर लीड स्पीकर डॉक्टर डी बी सिंह, प्रोफेसर डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एंटोमोलॉजी, काइंडली स्टार्ट हिज प्रेजेंटेशन। डॉक्टर डी बी सिंह। यस डॉक्टर डीवी सिंह। डॉक्टर डीवी सिंह, आर यू हियरिंग मी? मेरी आवाज आ रही है सब लोगों को?
जी सर, हमें तो आ रही है सर।
डॉक्टर डीवी सिंह की स्लाइड तो आ गई है। डॉक्टर सिंह, आर यू हियरिंग मी?
यस सर, आई एम हियरिंग यू प्रॉपरली।
ओके, और डीवी सिंह जी को आ रही है उनकी?
डॉक्टर डीवी सिंह जी, और सुधीर जी देखिए, इनका आवाज नहीं आ रही है। कोई हमारी तरफ से तो नहीं कोई प्रॉब्लम है?
उनकी पिक्चर को प्रिंट कर देना जिससे कि वो गैलरी में दिखें।
गैलरी में तो वही दिखेगा जो प्रेजेंटेशन देगा।
हाँ हाँ, माय वॉइस इज क्लियर टू ऑल?
हाँ, आप शुरू करिए सर। बिल्कुल बिल्कुल।
ओके ओके डॉक्टर सर।
ओके, कैन आई स्टार्ट?
श्योर श्योर, वेलकम वेलकम।
ओके, थैंक यू सर। एज आई जस्ट रेस्पेक्टेड टू चेयरमैन डॉक्टर एस एस गौरव सर, को चेयरमैन डॉक्टर नौसाद जी एंड रिपोर्टियर डॉक्टर अभिषेक जी, वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। अपार्ट फ्रॉम दिस, आई वुड लाइक टू अप्रिशिएट डॉक्टर एस के सिंह जी who has taken pain to organize this international webinar in this COVID crisis period. As we all are aware that COVID-19 has hampered all the activities, including agriculture and also in the field of livestock also. There are several problems faced by all unit, just you can say mentors, and in this way, the beekeeping has also got several hamperedness in the feeding and colony management and all. So today's topic is present status and future prospects of beekeeping in India. As we all know, I would like to start this presentation by giving you a quote which has been quoted by a scientist, Einstein. Einstein, Albert Einstein has once said, if the bee disappear from the surface of the earth, man would have no more than 4 years to live. No more bees, no more pollination, no more men. In this continuation also it is said, if bees, towards bees, if we die, we are taking you with us. Bees are saying like this. Finally, we can say without this, without bees, there would be no flower plants. And vice versa, without plants flowering, there would be no bee. So this is the thing which depicting the importance of beekeeping and their pollination services. Apart from the pollination services, importance of the bee products, which we will discuss later on during whole the presentation. We can say diversity of fauna and flora all are is important and paying us. In this, in the introductory slide, we will say that the beekeeping is the Latin word and originated from apis cultura. You can say apis cultura, meaning the cultivation, bee cultivation through education. Bee cultivation through education may be done in a very good manner, and the beekeeping is, you can say, is a art and skill of managing the bees. There are several advancements which has been done nowadays, but it was previously done by our ancestors through the ancient ways, that they were hunting the honey by making several kind of arrangement, like smoking the bees, and when the bees get away from the hive, then they have just harvested honey, or they have just done several other means by doing these kinds of the managemental practices, then they have just got the honey. But now in the modern era, the movable hives, that is length straw hive or Newton's hives, has been invented by the scientists, which are very good, and we can do the managemental practices in a fascinating way. And production of hive products, including honey, may be obtained in a very easy manner. And also, it has given us opportunity to guard the pollination services by bees. It has been also said about the bees that these are the best pollinators among all which are performing the pollination activities. If you will see, beekeeping is also not a traditional kind of beekeeping in these days. It has gone a very good upliftment, and it is of a high profit enterprise, which does not interfere with and it provides a very good also. So in this way, we can say that beekeeping plays a great role in agricultural diversification. If we will look into, then you will see that 87 leading food crops are there, where the bees are providing cross-pollination activities. Through this cross-pollination activities, we are getting the increased production of hive products as well as the crop yields also. If you will see, it has been also said by scientists that pollinators affect 35% global agriculture production, and these are the very rising enterprise. If we will see about the products, then we are getting six very important products from this beekeeping. And you can see there are honey. These are having the several medicinal values also. They are having the values for curing the diabetes. It is also increasing the memories in the human beings. It is useful in ulcers, several hemorrhoids problems, and sore throat treatments and all. There are several medicinal properties which they are performing. Similarly, the wax is also very important in the candle making industries. Apart from this, you can just use it in crayons, waterproofing, lip balm, lipsticks, etc. There are so many uses, industrial uses, by which it has got very good market value and use in different ways. Similarly, the third one product, which is the propolis, is also having the medicinal property to fight from the infections, and several other problems like wound care and from the other infectious point of view, it is also very good and used in the just bee glue, etc. Royal jelly, as we all are aware about this, it is a very nutritious product which has been used to feed the larvae and queen. For the using in the queen, it is very much importance. If we want to just prepare any queen, we have to feed these queens with the royal jellies, which is very nutritious and giving the preparedness to the vigorous queen in very short time. And next product, you can see the bee venom. As the name denotes, venom. Venom is not like that. It is having some very good properties and used in the osteoarthritis and some nerve treatments also, some skin treatments also against anti-inflammatory, but the process of extraction of this bee venom is very crucial. Once we want to get the bee venom from the bees, we have to put these electric shock, then we can make arrangement below the wire. We can keep the pots, glass pots, where we will get the, they will just sting in that after that shock, and the venom will come to the pot, and we can scrap the venom and use by further processing for different point of view, as we have discussed. Some peoples are also taking stinging in their knees for the treatment of arthritis. So this is having medicinal value. Also, next one product is that is pollen, is proteinaceous and used for bodybuilding and used also as a food source. Now, if you want to see, you can see the site of apiary, as we can just install the sites in this manner, and we can have, there is no need, even it is said that landless farmers may also install the apiary in their backyard, and they can earn within few investment. Even you can say 4 to 5 thousand investment for one high box with nucleus culture, they can start this enterprise and they can get benefit out of it, and they can perform all the responsibilities of them, which is assigned to them towards the family. So this is not a traditional kind of beekeeping. Now it has got a momentum. It has got a upliftment to earn more, to perform all activities with the earning of this. Now importance and scope of beekeeping. If we will say about the importance and scope of beekeeping, then we can say it is a subsidiary or whole-time occupation. If you want, you can take whole-time business as a whole-time business with this apiculture. If you will see, there are three kind of activities side by side in this. You can see the activity, one activity, major activity is honey production. Side by side, after honey production, you can manage the different products production from the apiary. And after this production of the apiary products, you can sell it very easily. There is no problem in the sale. In this way, the generation of sources of income, you will see a excellent source of income is there as compared to other kind of the enterprise. It is very easy because of the very less time, in a very less expenditure, you can earn much more as compared to other enterprises. There is a one solution also for employment opportunities. If you will see, there is a lot of employment opportunities in form of bee products producer, honey producer, and if you are performing the pollination services, even some of the technical persons, they are having their apiaries, and they are going along with transporting their apiaries to the next field where the demand is there, and they can install their apiaries there for pollination services on rental basis. So this is a very good employment providing opportunity in ways of product production, honey production, as well as apiary pollination services through the cross pollination of the plants, which are giving higher yield as compared to the non-pollination pollinated crops. The need for deploying around, it is mentioned in some books, 150 million bee colonies for pollinating major agricultural crops in the country. But recently, it has been changed that we can install 4 crore colonies in the country for pollination of major agricultural products. In this way, the value addition of high products may also be increased or may also be done like in the into lotion or soap or lipstick, etc. We can add the values for getting the more earning and all. There is no special requirement of land. If you will see in any enterprise, we must have to have the land, either 1/4 hectare or less than this or more than this. But this is the enterprise for the poor peoples where no land is required, no money is required. If they are having 4,000 rupees, they can start 2 hive boxes and they will get the honey for their domestic use, for family use, in out of that 2 hives only. In this way, this is a very good enterprise, you can say, for the poor peoples. No competition with other agricultural enterprises for the resources. As you can see, it is not just doing any kind of competition from any enterprise adjacent to this, and not required heavy initial investment. There is no heavy initial investment is required in case of this apiary. You have a very less amount. Either you if you have no money, you can go to the bee board, national bee board, where the provisions are there for free training and providing some loans, and along with that loans, 40% subsidy is also there. You can use that and you can just perform the activities with the help of that. And the ideal as a part-time occupation also. Suppose you are doing some other enterprise or some other activities, you can keep some colonies for side-by-side management for earning some more money with this unit also. Requires simple equipments, as you know. There are hive tools. You can see uncapping knife and bee wheels. Several other small things, honey extractor. These are the very small things which you can purchase for one apiary site within 50,000. All equipments in the 50,000, and you can start the 100 boxes, high boxes, in I think 2 lakh rupees total, along with equipments and high boxes with nucleus culture. So this is very good as compared to the other enterprise. Beekeeping is a multiple source of income. As you know, we will get the money out of selling the honey. Apart from the honey, we can sell the products of the apiary. Along with apiary, we can provide the pollination services either to the other farmers whoever is needy, or we can just continue this pollination services in our self crops, where we can get increased yield. Pollination by bees improves the quality and quantity of the crops. You have must have seen in case of the mango orchard, if there is no pollination, there will be some immature fruits that will be shed off from the twig. If pollination is there, they will stay, and the quality, shape, and quantity, all the things will be increased after 1 year. For this wonderful services.
Dr. D.V. Singh, sorry for interruption.
No
actually,
problem,
we have placed maximum 25 minutes with question answer. So I request you to please wind up as soon as possible, so we can have some question answer.
Okay, how much time you are giving, sir?
5 more minutes.
5 minutes more?
Yes,
it
sir.
It is very difficult to wind up, sir. I was actually
having
information for 1 hour.
Actually,
sir, I will try, sir.
We have many participants.
I will try to manage within 5 minutes, sir. Okay, sir. So there are 4 species for this kind of the services. You must be knowing these. Out of these, 2 are the wild species. That is Apis dorsata, also known as rock bee or giant bee, and another one is little bee, Apis floria. that is also a wild bee, and two is domesticatable bees, that is Apis sirena indica and Apis mellifera. These are the two good bees from which we can take the production works, if you will see, because the time is very less, I am going hurriedly from this presentation. There are two wild bees that are giving the honey very less, except Apis dorsata. Apis dorsata is wild, but it is giving good honey. That is, you can see the 36 kg per comb per year, but other is giving very less honey, 500 grams to maximum 5 kg in a year per comb. But only the Apis mellifera is the bee, which is very domesticatable and giving the around 40 to 60 kg honey from a comb from the bees. Now, there are several regions, as you know, north, south, east, west, for that that the bees has been divided from which region, which bees can be used. Now, honeybee as a best pollinators, as you know, we have already discussed, because of the paucity of the time, I can say it is good by having the bee basket in their legs, and it is collecting the honey very efficiently. The present status you will see, we can say in manufacture of the products, we are having the 8th rank. And in case of the production of the honey, we are having the 7th rank. And in case of the, if you will see exports, we are having the 6th position. In this way, this is not the enterprise which is just limited to the only the villages. It has got upliftment to export also. That's why it is very remunerative. If you will see, the largest honey export partners of India, you will see there are 3-4 partners which are contributing. Biggest Indian port, you can see there is already available with us. Honey production in India is good. Now the this honey is also produced in the other states very good, especially in Maharashtra and all. And we can say there are several present schemes like the Western Ghat Development Program, Prime Minister's Employment Generation Program, Marathwada Vikas Yojana, and National Horticulture Mission Scheme of Atma through Agriculture Department. They are just doing wonderful job for increasing the honey production. You can say there are several in need of honeys. We have to manage, because we cannot use indiscriminately the pesticide here. We have to manage from non-pesticidal management through non-pesticidal management or some neem-based products as and when we require for this. One very bad enemy of this apiary, you can say this beer, which has damaged very badly the hives and all. And apart from there, several insects are also damaging the apiary. In this way, you can say very much destructor is the Varroa mite, which may be taken into consideration for the management. Major constraints of beekeeping, if you will see, then you can get the efficient management of colonies through the technical knowledge is lacking, and lack of infrastructure from grassroots level. And one very much lacuna is there is no national level institute of beekeeping, which is wanting for promotion of this apiary very well. And bees are also very good yielder. Five products, as we have already discussed. A reason for bee declining, one of the most prominent reason is habitat loss, less forest and shelter for bees. We are destroying its habitats very non-judiciously. Climate change disrupting the bee behavior, and pesticidal including neonicotinoids harming bee health. as we are very well known that once we will use indiscriminately without safer use, then it will destroy our honeybees, which is very important. Now, pests and diseases are also very much problematic to this industry. Now, we will come to the next aspects. Modern apiculture is having the hives and all, and with the help of that, we can manage very good. If you will see the funds flow situation, you can get very well. Then fund flow situation is with the help of the National Bee Board is very good. Here, several other bodies are enclosed with this, like ABIC, NHM, SHM, NGOs, AICRPs, SAUs. These are the bodies which are getting funds from the National Bee Board. Apart from the this kind of activities, Bee Board is also financing to the different farmers for different kinds of the works. Future prospects, if you will see, then you can say honey industry in the country can be become a major foreign exchange earner as the things are increasing, exports are increasing, and we have to only do the national standards which we have to meet out. Beekeeping is an age-old tradition in India, but it is considered as no investment profit-giving venture into most of the areas. Now it has changed. It is a very profitable venture for doing this in form of the product production along with the pollination services. Honey production is a profitable business and generates employment along with income. It is a informal sector providing up to 70% of the honey and bees wax market in India. Some is to be just sent as a need of the export. And Indian honey has good export market with the use of modern colonies, storage, beekeeping equipment, processing, and packaging, etc. Potential export is also there. Market is also tracked. If you will see, there are some do's and don't do's in case of the bees.
Sorry, Dr. Saab, dobara rokne ke liye.
I will conclude.
Thank you.
So, do's and don't do's are only considered that we can just use the judiciously pesticides, and don't do's is including non use of the fumigation and non judicious use of the pesticides. Mm-hmm. And the conclusion, if you will see, these are the as best pollinator and yielder. Apis mellifera can be opted for production of the honey and honey products in India is good. And there is need of deploying the 4 crore colonies for providing the pollination, which is a major agricultural activity for crop yield in the country. Beekeeping can just employ 250,000 people in India and provide employment opportunities. Beekeeping is excellent and multiple source of income by providing part-time occupation. So there is a great potential and scope of beekeeping in the country. With this, I would like to thank our chairman, organizer, Dr. S.K. Singh, and all the participants and dignitaries of this webinar. Thank you very much for patience hearing. If you have any questions, you are most welcome.
Thank you very much. Yes, sir. One question from Ms. Ruby. Is nectar production reduces pollen collection?
What?
Nectar production. Is nectar production reduces pollen collection?
What? Fodder collection?
Pollen collection.
I'm clearing the question. Is basically he's saying the production of nectar. Honey.
Okay.
If the production of nectar reduces the export or foreign money, so has any relation with the foreign exchange if nectar production is less? That is the question, I think.
This is the question.
Yeah.
As you know, the forager bees are collecting nectar and pollen from the plants. It is mainly from the flower parts and some from the other parts body of the plants. I think it is required for the production of the honey. So there is no problem. It has not, in my knowledge, as far as my knowledge is concerned, that it will decrease. It is required for this enterprise, collection from the flowers and plant parts.
Thank you, Dr. D.V. Singh. We have short of time, and I also wanted to one question, if you allow.
Please.
Yes. Professor Singh, first of all, lot of congratulations. You have given a very good lecture, and keeping an audience, in especially in this era, agriculture is one of the most significant area of business as well as livelihood. So your topic of talk is fantastic. My question is, if anybody wanted to start a startup or incubation, so how they can start a startup business and at district level or at central level or state level they should approach, and how to approach? So new agriculture students or PG student, if they wanted to start a startup, they can involve in this.
They can, very question, sir. This is very valid and important question. They can contact directly.
जो लोग बात कर रहे हैं अपना म्यूट कर लें. बहुत लोग बात कर रहे हैं, प्लीज म्यूट कर लें, बात ना करें. यस सर जी.
They can contact, sir, their nearby agriculture university. There is in the headquarter also a provision of providing the training. Otherwise, if they are in other districts of the Western UP or in any states, they can contact to KBKH, that university. There one entomologist is there. He will provide all the required things, including the training. There is already the 10 to 15 boxes available at each KBKH. So he can provide the training and the requirements of this apiary. Broadly, I can say, if he wants, he can just purchase a colony. It will cost only 5,000 rupees for one hive box, and he can start with the 50 box in 2 lakh rupees, and he will get all returned within a year from this. Next year, he will be in profit 100%. This is the remuneration which you can get out of this apiary.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Welcome,
so,
sir.
We were hearing Professor D.V. Singh, who is the professor of entomology in the Sardar Vallabhbhai University. He has given very fantastic lecture, significant lecture, and especially that can be used by the agriculture graduate and postgraduate to uplift their livelihood, their business, and they can use their study. So really, I am very thankful to Professor D.V. Singh. And now we are going to initiate oral presentation. So before calling our first presenter, I request all the oral presenter, please be ensured that your presentation have to be clear within 8 minutes. So 2 minutes we can discuss questions. So now I am calling first person, oral presenter, that is Saurabh Padmasali. Saurabh Padmasali is from Indira Gandhi Krishi Vishwavidyalaya, Raipur. So I request Dr. Sri Saurabh Padmasali, please initiate your presentation.
Hello, sir. Am I audible? Sir, am I audible?
Very volume is very low. Make some high volume from your laptop or mobile.
Now I am audible.
Yeah, you are audible, but volume is low. Please increase your volume from your laptop.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Can you see the screen?
Yes, yes, you are audible, but volume is less. ये मुझे ही कम आ रही है, बाकी सब लोगों को अच्छी आ रही है.
नो सर, वॉल्यूम इज लेस सर, वॉल्यूम प्रॉब्लम.
प्लीज इंक्रीज योर वॉल्यूम फ्रॉम योर लैपटॉप और व्हाटएवर यू यूजिंग.
okay now, sir?
Not good. You can speak loud, quite
okay,
loud.
No problem. No problem.
Okay, please speak loud so we can hear.
Is the screen visible?
Yeah, you are visible and your screen is okay.
Okay, okay. A very good morning to the co-chairman and the chairman of the session and all the members of the advisory committee or organizing committee and to the, all the present participants of this session. I welcome you all. First of all, I want to express my heartfelt gratitude and thanks to the organizing committee for selecting my abstract for the oral presentation in this international webinar on post-COVID research advancement in the arena of agriculture, environment, and the life sciences, organized by the REDS in association with the Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. So as you can see, the topic of my presentation is feeding efficiency of the larval predator, Rhinochorus marginatus fabricius, that is Hemiptera reduvidi, on Corsera cephalonica stenton larvae, Lepidoptera pilidae larvae under the in vitro condition. So I will complete my presentation under the following five heads, that is introduction, material required, methodology, result, and the conclusion. And you can see some pictures I have shared. The first one is the reduvid predator on which the whole experiment is going on, that is the reduvid bug Rhinochorus marginatus, which was given the larvae of rice meal moth, that is Corsera cephalonica, to feed. This larvae are reared on basically the rice-based diet for this experiment. Before going to the introduction, I can say that some of the participants who are not from the entomological level confuse the reduvid bug with the red cotton bug. So I would like to clear this confusion first. You can see in the systematic position, the difference starts at the family level where the reduvid bug is from the reduvid bug and the red cotton bug from the family Pyrocoridae. Also, when you go for the morphological difference, the bug is red in color, whereas the red cotton bug is slightly orangish with a spot on the wing. Some more morphological differences that we can see in the lower pictures. The reduvid is basically a predatory bug, or we can say it is carnivorous bug, whereas the red cotton bug is a herbivore. The reduvid bug has lateral flanges on the abdomen because the word reduvid is derived from the Latin word reduvia. This comes from the lateral flanges, here lateral jump for external. ये तो होता है वो reduvid में present होता है, but it is not present in red cotton bug. No white line present on the abdomen of reduvid bug, whereas it is present on the abdomen of red cotton bug. These are basically the deposition of the excretory material or the urine, which it stores in the abdominal sections. Also, the rostrum, if we see in the reduvid bug, it is slightly bent at an angle because it is predatory. And whereas in case of red cotton bug, it is directly bent and there is no angle bent, you can see. Now coming to the introduction of the reduvid predator, that is larval reduvid predator, we can see the systematic position. The subfamily to which the Rhinochorus belongs is the Harpactorini subfamily. This reduvid bugs are also known as the accession bugs or mostly the kissing bug, and they are alate, that is winged insect. They are entomosuchivorous, feed on insects or the soft body insects. They are polyphagous. They are generalized predators and feed on anything they want. They see. They are polymorphic. That is, different forms of this reduvid bugs are present. They are crepuscular and active mostly during the evening time or at the night time. They are multiple time and they complete a lot of generations during a year. And they are voracious predators, which are basically found in the jungles, semi-arid zones, tropical rainforest, and the agroecosystem. These reduvids are found to predate on more than 20 economical important agricultural insect pests, which are belongs to Lepidopteran or the caterpillars.
Hello.
See the references below taken.
Hello.
Now, am I audible?
Yeah.
You can see that in present era, we are, as we see that about, we are talking about the COVIDs and all these things. That new pest diseases, these are continuously growing and emerging out in the environment. And as we have seen during this COVID, the nature has, recovered.
Sir, boliye main aapko to panel mein le liya tha.
The nature has mostly recovered and
so, sorry to interrupt. I request organizers, please mute all other than speaker. Many other disturbing voices are coming. Speaker ke alawa sabhi logon ko mute kar dijiye.
ओके सर
सुधीर
कुमार जी
नहीं नहीं ज्वाइन मैं आपको सेटिंग में कर देता हूं
तो we are seeing that presently people are becoming more and more aware about the organic farming and use of the biological control agents, because we can see that the harmful effects of the chemical control was outweighing its advantages, basically. So we can see most of time to time scientists have also encouraged the biological control because it is ecologically sound, economically it is viable, and socially it is also acceptable when we talk about the biological control using the predaceous arthropods. Basically, much attention has been given by the scientists up to year 2000. Intensive, we can say, researches and surveys are going on to find out more, and most of the biological control agent which can be used in agriculture purpose. So the scientists have also found that reduvids can be a very important bioagent for the product, for the management of the Lepidopteran larvae. Reduvids are found to feed on lots of insect pests of the crops, such as in rye, pest of rye, sugarcane, cotton, soybean, pea jenty, castor, tobacco, okra, pumpkin, brinjal, citrus, along with all the horticultural crops as well as the plantation crops. The importance of this reduvid is that they are less specific in their choice of prey. We can say they are generalized predators and they kill more than they need to saturate themselves. But whether they want to eat or not, they just kill the prey first and then feeds later on. The effectiveness of this biological control has also been seen by the field releases, and is found to be very much effective. Their success is based on this morphological and the physiological adaptations of this predator and the extraoral digestion. Here, extraoral digestion means when the larva, when we see the nymph or the adult reduvid bug, it is having the piercing sucking type of mouth part, and when it stings the prey, it releases some enzymes and the digestion starts in the body of prey only. So there is extraoral digestion. It is a general life cycle of the Rhinochoeus marginatus. We can see the life cycle here is divided into three basic stages, that is egg, nymph, nymphalin stars, and the adult. So here we see the five nymphalin stars. The mating, after mating, the female is a group of bunch of eggs of, we can say these are cigar-shaped eggs or the barrel-shaped eggs, from which the ant-like small first instar nymph comes out. And as soon as they came out of the egg, hatch out, they start feeding and they start predating. This predation continues up to the fifth instar and is followed by the adult stage also. And we can say the total life cycle is completed in almost 60 to 67 days, or it may also go up to 90 days also, in some cases reported. Now, in this presentation or the research I have done, we are going to see the material methods used are the reduvid bugs basically, and the egg stage is preferably used to start the experiment. We have used petri plates, forceps, and brush to handle the nymphs and the larvae. The zigzag paper strip, here you can see the zigzag paper strip. It is basically used to increase the surface area or inside the petri plate and provide a space to for the nymph to hide. We can say the corsara larvae which are used here are basically reared on the rice. It is known as the rice meal moth. Several experiments have been done on different diets, but rice is found to be the best diet for rearing of Rhinochoeus marginatus. So how to rear this corsara on the rice? The corsara rearing method is basically standardized by the NBIR Bangalore. The method includes the rice was first sterilized in the hot air oven at 100 degrees centigrade for 1 hour. After cooling, the rice was crushed in the mixer grinder, and 1.5 kg of rice was kept in each plastic basin. Generally, for corsara rearing, wooden boxes are used, but here to economically how to lower down the price of production, we are used plastic basins. So 30 centimeter diameter and 10 centimeter height plastic basins were used, in which 1.5 kg of grain is put in each of the container. 5 ml of 10% honey solution with a 5 gram of yeast and a pinch of streptomycin also mixed in the container. Here the honey solution is used to provide the moisture. Yeast helps in proper digestion to the larvae, and the streptomycin helps in as an antibacterial agent and stops the bacteria growth. Finally, the container was charged with 0.25 cc, that is about 5,000 eggs of Corsara cephalonica using a sieve. It is spread, and each container was then covered using a muslin cloth and kept. From these container, from the when the eggs will hatch out, the larva will come out, and the larva continue to grow in this container only. Now, under the experimental details of this present investigation, the site of or the location of study was the Biological Control Lab of Department of Entomology, College of Agriculture, Raipur. we have taken 6 treatments, taking the stars and the life stages as the treatments with 3 replications of each. The statistical design followed was random, completely randomized design or CRD. And the laboratory conditions were controlled at temperature of 27 plus minus 2 degrees centigrade and the relative humidity 70 plus minus 10 percentage. Now coming to the methodology used here, 30 nymphs of the Rhinochorus marginatus.
Dr. Saurabh.
Yes,
you have only 2 minutes, so please give your significant findings.
Yes,
sir. So everyone can go for the findings good.
Sure, sir.
Important.
So here, 10 nymphs were kept, nymphs of Rhinochorus are kept in each of the petri plate, and the larva, according to the suitable instar, is provided. Here, as per the stage of the nymph, we will provide the stage of the larva so they can kill it properly. If the nymph is first instar, and you will provide the letter instar larvae, then the larvae will web completely and the nymph will get entrapped. And the observations were then taken, recorded daily till the death of the adult. And the number of total larvae fed by the nymphal instars as well as adult were recorded to test the feeding potential, and the data were subjected to statistical analysis. Now coming to the result, we found a significant difference in almost all the nymphal instars at the adult, that they are found potentially predators of the larvae. The rate of consumption gradually was found to increase from first instar to the adult stage. That we can see here, the first feeds on 5.67 larvae per buck, then second instar 8.33 larvae, 18.67 larvae in the third instar, 27 larvae per buck in the fourth instar, and fifth instar 43.67, and in the adult state 82 larvae per buck. So we came to an average of, it feeds an average of 185 larvae per buck during its complete life cycle, we can see. So it can also be seen in the table given here. We can see the numbers increasing of feeding from instar to instar, which we have taken in the as a treatment. So the lowest feeding was at the first instar, and the maximum was in the adult stage. Here's also the graphical representation, which shows the same thing as the table. Now coming to the conclusion, at last we can conclude that the present studies, the feeding efficiency of the status of Rhinochorus marginatus clearly reveals that all the nymphal instars and the adults are potential predators of corsaria larvae, and they can be potentially used against the Lepidopteran in the fields for the Lepidopteran insect pest. Hence, they can be used as a promising bioagent for the management of insect pest. Basically, the Lepidopteran which causes maximum harm to the crop, and it will ultimately help us for the sustainable crop production without residue. The chemical residues which are left due to chemical control, that will not be there. The irony here is that the potential predator for the Lepidopteran larvae, the Rhinochorus are not mass multiplicated or not commercialized for the insect pest management under the biological control. With this, we came to an end of this seminar or this presentation. Any questions are there?
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh Padmasali.
Yes, sir.
So if anyone have any query, so.
One question from participant side.
Yes, sir.
Why Rhinochorus marginatus are less specific in their choice of prey?
Less specific?
Yes.
Sir, basically if we see, there are about 2000 species of reduvids, of which 270 are found in India only. So, we can say there's a because there's a carnivores there, therefore they are less specific.
Oh.
They basically feed on the body fluid or the body sap of the insects or the soft body insects. Therefore they are less generalized, and we can use them against all the Lepidopteran larvae. They are not specific. That is the best advantage for to use it in the biological agent. Any other questions, sir?
So I think. The talk was very fantastic.
Thank you, sir.
Reason behind. Nowadays, we are surviving only with the help of agriculture and medicine during this COVID era. And how to manage agriculture by maintaining the environment. In that sense, your topic, selection of topic was very crucial and very significant. So I thank you for a nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
And, our co-chairs of this session, Dr. Nausad, has already joined. So I also welcome Dr. Nausad Khanji. He is associate professor in CSA UT Kanpur. So from the next speaker, Dr. Archana Singh, Scientific Officer, Sugarcane Research Institute, Muzaffarnagar. So I request Dr. Archana, please initiate your presentation. Dr. Archana has joined. Hello? Archana Singh, Dr. Archana is there?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So please allow her to join and continue her presentation. नहीं है तो नेक्स्ट स्पीकर को बुलाएं क्या?
सर, हम नेक्स्ट को कॉल कर सकते हैं.
सो डॉक्टर अर्चना सिंह, आई थिंक शी इज नॉट एबल टू कनेक्ट, विल कॉल हर अगेन. सो नाउ आई एम कॉलिंग टू डॉक्टर एस आर सिंह, ए साइंटिस्ट इन केवी के. हेलो.
यस सर.
डॉक्टर अर्चना सिंह को हेल्प कर दो थोड़ा, वो शायद वो कोशिश कर रही हैं ज्वाइन करने की, उनका अनम्यूट नहीं हुआ.
कर रही हैं
सर, स्लाइड शेयर कर रही
I think she is not able to connect. So I request Dr. Archana.
She is not able to connect.
Dr. Archana Singh, are you listening? So उनको बाद में connect कर देंगे जब तक वो समझ लें.
Hello.
Hello.
Dr. SR Singh from KV Katra.
Yes. Okay. So Dr. SR Singh, now he is here. So yeah. I request Dr. SR Singh.
Yes, sir.
Scientist KVK Hathras, please start your presentation.
Okay, sir.
Okay, and allow Dr. SR Singh, please
allow me. I
will. अपने 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 स्लाइड शेयर करिए, आप शेयर स्क्रीन पे जाइए.
सर, kindly start your video.
अपना वीडियो
से स्टार्ट
करिए.
डॉक्टर एसआर सिंह जी, अपना वीडियो ऑन कर, वीडियो से आइए और स्क्रीन शेयर में जाकर के अपनी स्लाइड्स को ओके करिए.
हेलो. हाँ डॉक्टर साहब, वीडियो से ज्वाइन करिए. डॉक्टर साहब वीडियो से.
डॉक्टर एस के सिंह जी, उनको आप फोन करके अलग म्यूट करके उनसे बात कर लीजिए, समझा दीजिए कैसे करना है, जब तक हम किसी दूसरे को बुलाते हैं, है ना. आप उनसे कॉल करके बता दीजिए स्टेप्स हाउ ही
कैन.
वीडियो आ गया
सर.
ओके डॉक्टर साहब, वेलकम. अभी म्यूट है आपका, म्यूट है शायद, आवाज नहीं आ रही. डॉक्टर सर,
हाँ सर, आ रही है.
यू आर मोस्ट वेलकम.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर.
डॉक्टर एसआर सिंह फ्रॉम केवी के हाथरस.
Yes, sir.
So I request you to please start your presentation.
Yes, sir. Okay,
welcome. You have 10 minutes only to complete your presentation.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Good morning to all of you.
Good morning to all of you.
My sincere to all of you.
Today,
I am going to present my presentation on
bio pesticide production and application.
As you know, in present scenario, there are so many constraints are open. That's why.
Hello.
आपके बहुत ज्यादा डिस्टरबेंस हो रहा है, कहीं पंखा तो नहीं चल रहा है, एसी या पंखा? एसी और पंखा चल रहा है तो, और दरवाजा बंद कर लीजिए अगर डिस्टर्ब हो रहा है।
आवाज डबल आ रही है।
The losses caused by different pests in India yields 33%, plant disease 25%, insect pest 20%, miscellaneous 9%, storage pest 7%.
आ जाओ भैया 10 मिनट बाद।
As per losses caused by different pests in India, reducing the production of around 25 to 30% in India. What is the biopesticides? Biopesticide key component of integrated pest management program are receiving much practical attention, a means of reduce the load of synthetic chemicals produced being used to control different crops. Why we need of biopesticides in present scenario? The more chemical pesticide used to control disease and control. So use of chemical pesticide is increasing year by year in Indian agriculture. That's why the biopesticide is more feasible and useful in Indian agriculture.
Stationary wala.
Then chemical pesticide.
बहुत बात कर लो मिला था कि ये सामान लेने कितने मिलेगा?
Of our country, 59.145 billion per year. Then destruction of beneficial.
काटो ना तुम 10 के अंदर करो.
As you know, there are so many creatures and pollution of soil, water and air, pesticides.
ले आओ ना हमारे कंप्यूटर
पे. Use of ideal biopesticide. What is the ideal
pesticide? बाकी लोग mute कर लीजिए please.
ER
करके अलावा सब लोग mute कर लीजिए, आवाजें आ रही हैं बहुत.
Safe to beneficial organism, genetically stable, effective at low concentration. As you know, they are more effective to control pests and diseases. Easy to multiply. We can multiply in very easily in lab condition. Effective against a wide range of pests. There are so many pests we can control through biopesticide prepared and easily distributed form and non-toxic to human and other animals, and the low cost. We can prepare biopesticide in very low cost, compatible with the other treatment and the pathogenic host plant. As you know, the field crops are more feasible. They are non-pesticide control genes. 5% microorganism, 30% semi chemical, 5% microorganism, 34% natural product, 35% microorganism in biopesticide. Microsporidia we use 2% nematodes, we are APN nematodes 9% and bacteria also, Bacillus subtilis also 36% and baculovirus. Especially NPV virus we are used in 16% and fungi mostly used in 49%. As you know, there are so many bio agents which are used to control seed-borne and soil-borne disease also. Microorganisms used in biocontrol, as you know, fungicides for the control of any disease, 35%, herbicides, 12%, and insecticides, 50%. As you know, there are so many, many weeds are emerging in our crop, so controlling of these weeds through chemical control is not more feasible. Major biopesticides available in India, as you know, bioinsecticide, azadirachtin, neem oil, and neem cake. They are trade name, eco name, nimbicidin, neemex, neem, achuk, rakshak, neem, FL, neem gold, etc. The HANPB and these are the viruses and bacteria based product which are used to against H. armigera, H. natura, Lepidopterans, H. armigera, DVM, whitefly, and thorn sucking pest, and soil arthropod also, which are very, very useful for the controlling of insect pests in our crops also. The mass production of trichoderma, it is very easy to product isolation of trichoderma from rhizosphere by dilution plate method in vitro condition, screening and selection of potential strain, identification, multiplication, soil state by using cheap agriculture waste by product, liquid state, and other. What is the mode of action trichoderma? Mycoparasitin, as you know, limits of growth and activity of pathogen fungi, antibiosis, production of lytic enzyme. They are produced many types of enzymes which break the cells of fungi. Competition for food and space. They also compete to food also. Mass for formulation of trichoderma species. Top waste be fermented biomass 15 liter. Top 30 kg. Carboxymethyl cellulose 150 gram. Vermiculite wheat bran formulation. Vermiculite 100 grams. Wheat bran 33 gram, wet for fermentation biomass 20 gram, HCl 20 ml. These are the formulations which are used. These are evaluation of different bioagent against fusion oxidation saccharide in vivo condition. The performance of trichoderma will be on different crops also. Field trials have been conducted. The colostomin are most effective. The BC ratio 1.19 is very effective in soil-borne and seed-borne disease. First registered biofungicide, trichoderma species is one of the EPA registered fungicide. And NPV is the virus-based fungicide which are used mostly through pod borers also, and also isolation of method. Collect the 250 dial caterpillars, put them in 1 liter sterilized water, crush them properly, keep the serpentine up to 24 to 30 hours, filter the suspiration based used for 1 hectare, apply to spray NPV first time of the caterpillars of American bollworm, tobacco caterpillars also.
Sir Singh ji, aapke paas 2 minute hain, aap usi hisab se kariyega.
Okay sir, I will summarize.
Okay, thank you.
Azadirachtin, neem oil are most useful in against the aphids, jessets, thrips, mealybugs, mites, whitefly, cabbage borer, soot borer, fruit borer, and others. This is very important. The dose of this azadirachtin 1 to 3 ml per liter. These are the active in ingredient. Retinins also, so if also a plant which are used to many pest control, and retinin, these are the active ingredient and mostly are used Coleoptera, Lepidoptera, Hemidoptera, Thinopsoptera, Hymenoptera, which are very crucial activities for 10 days. Pyrethrins also a plant which are known as Chrysanthemum, which are used the sucking pest like aphid, jacet, white fly, scale insect and insect stage also. This is a very most important. These are the semi-clonal biocontrol, also semi-chemicals. These also repel. This is the most important. Mass trapping, attract and killed method, attract ammonium bicarbonate, which are mostly are used for pod fly and fruit borers also. This is where commercialization of biopesticide. A number of companies are also developing new products, are in the process of being registered. Many of these companies are small, privately owned, with the limited product like Geltrol and AG Biochem also. Constraint and commercialization of pesticide. Some limited progress in notice in the technology formulation due to certain difficulty with these agents, which have hindered the development of three market. They are storage stability. As you know, storage capability of biopesticide is many constraint. Shelf life also. The biopesticide mostly used within the 1 year, and aerated biological efficacy after application to the seed have shown the growth and adoption of the technology. Limited understanding of rhizosphere ecology, the release of some product which did not meet expectation, the uncertainty of size of commercial opportunity, the strength of patents of the cost, future prospective. A variety of hello.
बताइए सुन रहे हैं, खत्म कर दीजिए.
सुन रहे हैं
आप कंक्लूड. हेलो, वी आर हियरिंग. नक्सब कंक्लूड.
ओके फ्यूचर प्रोस्पेक्टिव एंड बायोपेस्टिसाइड. कंज्यूमर शुड बी फुली अवेयर एफिकेसी ऑफ द बायोपेस्टिसाइड अगेंस्ट द डिफरेंट पेस्ट कंसर्न, स्टेबिलिटी ऑफ द बायोपेस्टिसाइड, कंप्लीट अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ रजिस्ट्रेशन एंड अदर इश्यूज, under control environment with specific crops such as vegetable and perspective of these products are good option to protect seed and seedlings under glass house condition. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I, if any questions from participants, and Mr. Dr. Abhishek will take care. Abhishek, kuch question hai kya organizers, participants se? अनम्यूट कर लीजिए अब शेख जी, आपका म्यूट
है. सर, नो एनी क्वेश्चन फ्रॉम पार्टिसिपेंट साइड.
आई हैव वन क्वेश्चन. मैं यस एसआर सिंह जी पूछूं.
सर, यस सर, पूछिए.
मेरा हां, मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि जो भी हमारे स्पेशली बायो एजेंट्स हैं,
यस सर, यस सर,
इसमें अगर जो बायो एजेंट हम लोग यूज कर रहे हैं, अगर उसमें किसी तरह का म्यूटेशन हो जाए तो उसको कैसे पता चलेगा? If there is any mutant, and the mutant may be harmful to the crop, then how we can understand and how we can detect that our biocontrol agent is not mutating under the bearing increasing temperature or increasing environmental condition, climate change का जो effect है,
yes sir,
उससे mutation वगैरह नहीं हो रहा है, इसको कैसे समझेंगे और कैसे सब बता सकेंगे आगे?
जी सर,
फील्ड कंडीशन में टेस्ट करने के बाद
नहीं
जैसे हमारा कमर्शियल प्रोडक्ट है नौशाद खान.
थैंक यू वेरी मच सर.
नौशाद खान जी सुन रहे हैं आप, तो आप डॉक्टर एस आर सिंह जी को थैंक यू बोल दें.
थैंक यू सर. नमस्कार सर.
अनम्यूट कर दीजिए नौशाद जी को. अब शेख जी अनम्यूट नहीं है अभी ना डॉक्टर नौशाद.
थैंक्स टू ऑल ऑफ यू.
थैंक यू डॉक्टर चेयरमैन सर, डॉक्टर गौरव सर फॉर कंडक्टिंग दिस टेक्निकल सेशन वेरी नाइसली. ऑल्सो आई एम थैंकफुल टू डॉक्टर एस आर सिंह साइंटिस्ट के लिए फॉर गिविंग ए वेरी रेलिवेंट एंड इंफॉर्मेटिव टॉक दैट हाउ वी कैन स्टे फ्रॉम द सीड बॉर्न एंड सॉइल बॉर्न डिजीजेस वेरी वेरी significant for yield loss. So this is very, I think this lecture is very fruitful for today's technical session. And now I again hand over the row to our chairman.
Thank you very much, sir. Again.
So thank you, Dr. Nausad Khan ji. Now I invite our next speaker. If Dr. Archana now able to connect us. Dr. Archana, are you hearing? Archana ji ne join kar liya hai. I think Dr. Archana has still not connected. So I am calling the next speaker, Mr. Sunil Kumar. He is a research scholar from CSA Kanpur. Mr. Sunil Kumar has connected.
No, sir,
I think Mr. Sunil is also not here. So next is the Dr. Manoj from Tamil Nadu. Dr. Manoj, have you connected? Organizers, Manoj, hai kya connect? Nahi hai?
No, sir.
Okay. So our next speaker is Dr. J.G. Hirappara. He is agromate observer. Dr. J.G. Hirappara is here.
No, sir. He is not.
Okay, so next speaker is Mr. Suresh Kumar, research scholar, RCA.
Yes, sir.
MP UAT Udaipur. I think he is here.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Suresh, are you hearing? Mr. Suresh, can you mute? Kariye. Hello? Mr. Suresh, are you ready to present? सुरेश जी को अनम्यूट करिए और पिन पॉइंट करिए. एसके सिंह जी, सुरेश को पिन पॉइंट कर दीजिए और
कैन यू अनम्यूट योर सिस्टम.
मिस्टर सुरेश,
यू कैन आल्सो स्टार्ट योर वीडियो.
प्लीज स्टार्ट योर वीडियो. एंड मिस्टर सुरेश,
आप अनम्यूट कीजिए और वीडियो स्टार्ट कीजिए. मैं आपको रिक्वेस्ट दे चुका हूं.
Mr. Suresh is, I think, not listening, and either he has off the video is not there. So next is Lalani Sairoz, a student from
yes,
Agricultural University. Very good, very good.
Yes, sir.
So please, I request of this.
Yes.
Pinpoint the video of Miss Lalani.
Please start your video.
Video start kariye. Lalani ji, please come with your video. हाँ, video इनको pin point कर दीजिए. अभिषेक जी,
pin point दिए.
इससे वो सबको screen में दिखें.
Yes, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Please, you can initiate your presentation.
Yes, sir. Hello?
Yeah, sure.
Hello.
Sure, welcome.
Good afternoon, everyone. Myself, Lalani Sairoz. I am from Junagadh Agricultural University. I am presenting my topic on Agnihotra, Homa Organic Farming. Topics that we are going to cover is introduction, what is Homa Organic Farming, what is Agnihotra, who practices Agnihotra, types of Agnihotra, procedure which follows during the Agnihotra, its effect on soil, plant, environment and water, review of literature, conclusion and future perspective. So what is Homa Organic Farming? So after the Green Revolution, we have first very used external inputs like seed, fertilizer, and we are facing ill effects on soil, water, plant, and environment. Basically, Homa organic farming means application of Homa therapy in agriculture, which means Homa therapy. The ancient Vedic science of the Yajna or Havan, which is used for the healing the environment, atmosphere, and Agnihotra is main backbone of ancient science of the Homa therapy, which is known as the Agnihotra. Agnihotra can be performed during the exactly two times, during the sunset and sunrise. Agnihotra is mainly a science of healing the atmosphere through the pyramid structure, which helping to elimination of the pollution and contamination. And it is also written in the Vedas that heal the atmosphere and it will heal you. Agnihotra, as the name says, Agni means fire and Hotra means healing through the fire. So it is a process which is based on the purifying the surrounding atmosphere by preparing fire using the cow dung cake, which is smeared with the cow ghee. And major most significant aspect of Agnihotra, it means it is combined the main energies of the five elements, sun, space, air, water, and earth into it. So who can practice this Agnihotra? Irrespective of any caste, religious, gender, age or race, anyone can practice this Agnihotra. So main, there are three types of Agnihotra. Agnihotra Homa, which is most important, it should practice at sunset and sunrise time. Vyashruti Homa, it can performed at any time except the sunset or sunrise. And Om Trimbakam Homa, it should be performed at least 4 hours in every day. As a Vedic procedure, Agnihotra fire required the following inputs. First, we want a pyramid, which is an inverted inner shape, pot, which is receiver of the cosmetic energy, and copper metal has been used, which is a best conductor of a heat. And here we are using the brown rice and without polishing because it has its nutrition value. Third thing is a cow dung cake, fourth is a cow ghee, and it all should be combined in a Agnihotra. And into it, Agnihotra mantras specifically at a specific time should be uttered. It is the procedure for the Agnihotra in which first we are preparing the fire. Here we can see in a clearly figure, third figure, that in a pyramid we have put a cow dung which is smeared with the cow ghee, and after the uttering a specific mantra at a sunrise time, we are adding rice brown grain with another mantra, and then this procedure should be kept to follow during the sunset and sunrise time. Here is the mantras which has been uttered during the sunrise time. Suryaya swaha suryaya idam namama, prajapataye swaha prajapataye idam namama. Here is the mantra which has been uttered during the sunset time. Agneya swaha agneya idam namama, prajapate swaha prajapate idam namama. Here is the mantra which is used in Om Trimbakam Homa and Vyashruti Homa. So how does Agnihotra work? So first rays of the sun, we can see in a figure that sun at a sunrise and sunset, solar energy is captured in a pyramid, an Agnihotra copper pyramid, which is a receiver and transmitting each energy up to the 12 kilometer into the biosphere. It has main so many effect on the shoot, and plant shows this positive feedback due to the main providing the specific atmosphere. Here is the analysis of a brown rice ash, cow dung ash, cow ghee, and Agnihotra ash has been shown among the different sample and different tested parameter. We can clearly see that highest percentage of Fe, aluminium, calcium, magnesium, and potassium has been seen in Agnihotra ash compared to all samples. So, how it would be worked? So it is known that when specific substance are burned into the copper pyramid with a specific mantra at a specific time, so the specific type has been created which helps in the plant growth. Here is the Agnihotra Homa hut. It is the main hut for the daily performance of the Agnihotra through the pyramid. Agnihotra ash, it would be cooled ash after the Agnihotra fire burned, totally burned, it would be collected and shaved and collected into the earthenware or a clay pepper or a wood. It can be used for the direct treatment of the seed and bulb in a mixture of a ratio of a cow urine and water 50-15% plus 4 tablespoons of Agnihotra and kept it in this solution seed and bulb for 30 to 40 minutes. And it has been provided antibacterial effect and protect the seed coat. It can be applied as a fertilizer or as a spray solution. We can see in a figure 2. Here is the different product of the Agnihotra ash. What is biosol? So biosol, Homa biosol, is a particularly liquid biofertilizer which is made up of the by involving the Agnihotra ash into it. It is the first developed by the Gloria in South America and which can be used for the fertilization for foliar spray for the food and medicine for the plant. So it is the material which is used for the preparation of the biosol. It is the effect of Agnihotra has been felt on all the plant, animal, human being, agriculture, insect, water, soil and animals. So the effect on plant. So effect of Agnihotra on the growth and yield of the Cerbera in a variety ruby organic farming shows the highest among the all the parameters, leaves per plant, leaf length, leaf width, fresh shoot weight, number of flowers and shelf life. Here is the comparison has been studied by the conventional organic agriculture, or conventional agriculture and Homa organic farming. It clearly shows that the, among the all the parameters, highest protein content, oil content has been highest in a Homa organic farming. Here is the effect of Agnihotra should be treated in a shoot length and root length. So we can see that the inner treated of Agnihotra should be highest shoot length and root length has been observed. Here is the effect of Agnihotra ash on the germination of the seed. So here is the first triplet. We have used only tap water in a control ash. We have used 1 gram normal ash without Agnihotra, without any mantra or Agnihotra. And the third Agnihotra ash in which we are using the 1 gram Agnihotra plus 100 ml water. So it would be increases the nutrient content and be used as a fertilizer. There is the biochemical efficacy of a Homa organic farming in the soybean has been studied. So the among the different treatment, pre-fall treatment, seed application treatment with Agnihotra Homa ash plus fresh cow dung, cow urine and biosol at 30, 45 and 60 days shows the highest total biomass, straw yield, grain yield and seed index compared to other treatments. Here is the effect on the soil. So solubility of a phosphate percentage gram in ash should be increases with the Homa farming in different types of the soil. Here is the effect on environment. So the in which distance it would be effective. So we can clearly see that plates when opened at near 10 feet to 20 feet, 30 feet and 40 feet and it was the colony has been counted.
Sorry to interrupt, Ms. Rani. Please bind up within 2 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Within 2 minutes, complete.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Yes, sir. So, microbial load has been decreases. So, effect on water. So, following photos has been shown that the Narmada River before the Agnihotra was added and after the Agnihotra should be added. Here is the sewage water treatment. So, we can see that the different parameters after the treatment with Agnihotra should be resulted into the less the total solid, total suspended solid hardness and DOD and CD has been also been reduced compared to before treatment. Here is the effect on time of the Agnihotra. So, the blue line shows that red line shows the sunrise and blue sunset. Which time should be flowerable? We can easily see through the graph. Here is the effect of mantra on Agnihotra. So line in a graph. Here is the effect of rice in a brown rice and white rice. So the brown rice has been shown in a red line. It has been shown as the more effect into the it rather than the white rice. Here is the effect of ghee on Agnihotra compared to cow ghee. Buffalo ghee, cow ghee has been found superior to increase the plant growth. So Above all these points, we can conclude that we have seen the highest environment, water, soil, plant yield would be higher in this. But if we are going to see the future perspective, so very much scientific information is regarding to this, it is available. So, and after finding out this all mechanism work, we will understand the how organic, homo organic farming is working. But if we are going towards
I think she has been disconnected. So I request Dr. Nausad Khan, please say her proposal vote of thanks so we can continue. Dr. Nausad ji.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me opportunity. Thank Ms. Nilani for delivering very good presentation on agriculture and Huma.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Actually, this concept is environment friendly, no doubt, but
sir, doctor.
Hello.
Hello.
Hello, could video rest? So I think there's some disturbances of internet problem is there. So thank you, Ms. Lalani, for your very special and different kind of presentation. And you are connecting with environment and agriculture and with our roots.
Yes, sir.
Thank you for your kind presentation. So now I request Dr. S.K. Singh, as it is 12:30. So we should bind up the session or I should be
thank you,
allowed
sir.
To present.
Sir, thank you. Now I request you to few words for this session, sir. To bind the session, sir.
Okay, so today...
Sir, Sunil Kumar, Mr. Sunga present here. So please, sir, give me 10 minutes for present my paper, sir.
Okay, so we have called you many times anyway.
No, sir, but sir, connectivity no fault.
No problem, Mr. Sunil has connected with us. He is a research scholar from CSA UT Kanpur. So I request Mr. Sunil, please bind up your talk. Giving the major important within 5 or 6 minutes.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay. Good afternoon to all panelists. Sir, my topic conservation agriculture for climate change mitigation. So, sir, heartily thanks to invite me and select me my paper for our presentation. So, sir, conservation agriculture is defined as sustainable agriculture production system comprising a set of farming practices adapted to the requirement of crop and local conditions of each region, whose farming and soil management techniques protect the soil from erosion and degradation, improve its quality and biodiversity, and contribute to the preservation of the natural resource, water and air, while optimizing yield. And main principles of conservation agriculture based on three principles. First one is minimum mechanical soil disturbance. Minimum soil disturbance refers to low disturbance, no tillage and direct seeding. The disturbed area must be less than 15 cm wide or less than 25% of the cropped area, whichever is lower. Second principle is permanent soil cover. Three categories are distinguished of permanent soil cover: 30% to 60%, more than 60% to 90%, and more than 90% ground cover. Area with less than 30% cover is not considered as conservation agriculture. Species diversification, rotation, association should involve at least three different crops. However, repetitive wheat, maize, or rice cropping is not an exclusive factor for the purpose of this data collection, but rotation association is recorded where practice is adopted for conservation agriculture. Why we do conservation agriculture? Conservation agriculture do for sustainability, enhance biodiversity, carbon sequestration. Carbon sequestration is essential for availability of micro and major nutrient for plant and other important objective of conservation agriculture to maintain healthier soil and increase yield and reduce cost. What we do for conservation agriculture, designing, formulating and planning national strategy and policies that provide incentive for farmers to adapt conservation agriculture practices and invest in a sustainable agriculture mechanization. This allows farmers, especially smallholders, to move away from inefficient agronomic management practice, manual labor, to appropriate level of mechanization that offer higher return. Training farmer services provide an extension agent on conservation agriculture practices and sustainable mechanization. Developing and dissemination training material help to raise awareness and to incorporate into agriculture university curriculum and government programs. Implementing location specific practices and identify suitable crops to improve production system that are resilient to the effect of climate change, as well as identify existing or potential marker for input. Another increasing agriculture production by implementing conservation agriculture practices in support of national priority linked to food and nutritional security. What is research gap in conservation agriculture? Because of in our country, farmer is not adopted conservation agriculture as large scale.
Sunil ji, एक मिनट में आप इसका जो भी आपका ये study है, इसके significant point एक मिनट में बता दीजिए. Within one minute.
जी सर. The research gap, the climate change mitigation potential and carbon sequestration mechanism under convention. Tillage and conservation tillage has not been studied thoroughly. Further, the soil health, enhancement and nutrient dynamics in conventional tillage and conservation tillage need to be studied appropriately. Hence, the present study is very important, timely in present climate scenario. So, sir, I will go to conclusion. Conclusion is that conservation agriculture is an approach to farming that seeks to increase food security, elevate poverty, conserve biodiversity, and safeguard ecosystem services. Conservation agriculture practices can also contribute to making agriculture system more resilient to climate change. And another conclusion, conservation agriculture is a base for sustainable agriculture production under climate change scenario. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so now if there is any query from participants.
No, any question, sir.
So I request again, our colleague Dr. Nausad ji, so he may convey the vote of thanks to.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, and thank you for Dr. Sunil for giving a presentation on climate change and its mitigation, and especially emphasizing about the conservation agriculture, how conservation agriculture could be helpful for mitigating the climate change scenario as well as increasing the carbon storage in the soil. Because although he have not presented any study or data that he has performed, but he has.
He is a student, sir.
But actually, he has put up his view that how conservation agriculture could be beneficial and how we can mitigate the climate change effect. Thank you, sir.
Okay, so thank you, Dr. Nausad. So I think this time is over for this session. So this session was started at 11. I have started as a chair of the session, and with us, Dr. Nausad Khan, who is from CSUT Kanpur, with us, and reporter Mr. Abhishek Singh is continuously noting all the details of the presentation. And our first speaker was the lead speaker, Professor Dr. D.V. Singh from the Department of Entomology, Sardar Vallabhbhai University. So he has very well presented, very well explained how to start incubation center, how to take beekeeping as an opportunity to basically go for the new students. He has given very exhaustive explanation of the beekeeping as a scientific way as well as a commercial way, in both the way. So I think the best presentation we can regard that is given by Dr. D.V. Singh. Really, we are fortunate enough to hear such a fantastic this year. Other, we have actually registered, there were 8 speakers, but out of 8, only 4 speakers had turned up. And one speaker, I think, due to some technical issues, Dr. Archana, scientific officer, Sugarcane Research Institute, she could not able to join. And while 4 speakers, Mr. Saurabh Padmasali from IGKV Raipur, Dr. S.R. Singh from Scientist KVK Hathras, and Mr. Suresh from MPUT, and Ms. Lanani from Junagadh Agriculture University, and Mr. Sunil Kumar from CSUT, just we are here, we have here all. So all the oral speakers, they were also very fantastic. And this is very good that all the talk were very diversified in nature. They're not taking more time. And I thank to all the organizers, all the speakers, my co-chair, and Dr. Professor Nosad Ji, and my reporter, Mr. Abhishek Ji, being with us during conduct of this smooth session. I'm also thankful to Dr. S.K. Singh for organizing such a wonderful conference. So now time is already 12:40. I was also supposed to present. If it's required, then I can present. Otherwise, it's okay. We can be done in another time.
Sir, आप जो कर दे सकते हैं आप अपना बताएं।
Time है आपके पास?
हाँ हाँ, 10-15 मिनट आप बोलिए सर, कोई नहीं।
Okay, okay.
आपके लिए है सर। जब सब सबका आप सुन और आपका भी तो सुन सकते हैं सब लोग।
नहीं सर, सर का सुनना जरूरी है सर।
नहीं
काफी देर से सुने भी नहीं सबको।
Again, I am also facing the same problem. My slides are visible. Okay. So now, if my slides are visible to all, I can start.
Yes, sir. Okay.
My video is also clear. Video is also clear.
Yes. Very clear, sir. Please.
Okay. Thank you. So thank you, Dr. S.K. Singh, and all the organizers for giving me a chance to speak. So today I'm going to talk about BPVN FRA. Ji?
Slide to put you can see.
Slides are not visible?
Okay, sir. इतने से समझ में आ जाएगी. अदरवाइज आप एक्सप्लेन कर ही रहे हैं।
नहीं दिख नहीं रही क्या स्लाइड?
दिख रही है सर।
दिख रही है।
दिख रही है।
So my topic is PPV and FRA, that is protection of plant varieties and farmers' right. I have prepared this slide keeping in mind that most of the student from UG and PG from agriculture stream, they have been connected, and that this topic may be useful to the student. I know that most of our scientists, they are well aware about this PPV and FRA, but I request all the students, please listen this. So this purpose of this particularly act, why this act came and what are the use, so one by one very speedily I will explain because we have very less time. So first purpose was to basically to provide the establishment of an effective system of protection of plant varieties. It's basically with the help of farm, because already we have a PVR, that is breeder's right, but in PVR, under PVR, farmers were not allowed to register their variety, to protect their variety. That's why this particular PPV and FRA Act came into existence. And second purpose was to basically to recognize and protect the rights of the farmers in respect of their contribution made in the form of if they are working as a conservator, conserving the variety, or if they are making any improvement in the variety, or they are basically making available to the plant-genetic resources for the development of new variety, or they are supplying plant-genetic resources to any institution of the use. So this was another purpose to bring this act. Similarly, to protect plant breeders' right to stimulate research. So this particular PPV and FRA Act was also coordination with the PBRs, because plant breeders has also, they are engaged. So the farmers and plant breeder and their work connectively, they can be coordinated to each other. That was another purpose of this act. And this was also to facilitate and basically to make available high quality of seeds and planting material to the farmers. That was another purpose of this act. So the headquarter of this act is, I think all you know, it is at NAS complex in campus of IRA New Delhi. So how, why be required particularly, and what is the mechanism to protect the plant varieties? So this came into basically with the agreement of the TRIPS under Article 23.7b. So we can protect this plant or register the plant variety under the way of patenting. That the method that is described in the plant breeder rights. Either we can go for the sui generis system, means any system that is suitable to the government of a concerned government. So government, they can modify, they can, as per the requirement, so variety can be registered, or the combination of both can be taken. So some part of the patent or some part of the new modified methodology can be adopted. Purpose of basically, anyhow, if any new variety or good variety is there and farmers wanted to register the variety, then farmers should be allowed to register variety either by the patent or by the combination of both or by the sui generis mechanism. So now basically, who are the farmers? The farmers are not only those are making the husbandry of crop. Normally, this is very misconception that farmers mean those are cultivating the crop. So under this PPV and FRA Act, the definition of farmer is quite broad. So anyone or any person who are cultivating the crops, this is the only one area of defining the farmers. So any person, those are directly cultivating their produce or the cultivating the crops, they are the farmers. Another, any person, those are directly or indirectly supervising the cultivation of the land. So means here we can say the contract farming. Any industry or any individual, those are taking the land in the this rent, or they are supervising only in the capacity of supervising. The contract farming, another kind of allied farming, they also comes under the farmer. The person is also called farmer, who is supervisor in capacity. And another is the any conservation and preservation, jointly or individually, while the wild species, traditional varieties, or any such varieties, or useful plant genetic resources that is significant for the purpose of crop improvement. So any individual, whether they are the scientist or they are farmers or anyone, those are indulged in the mechanism of conservation and preservation of domestic or wild or traditional, any kind of variety or germplasm resources, they will also consider the farmer. So now we can see the farmers, the concept of farmer is very broad. Now there are the term, the extant variety. When we use the variety means normally we say the extant variety. Any variety which are notified, released under the section 5 of Seed Act 1966, now it has been revised in 2004. So their whole procedure is there, not required to describe here. And farmer's variety or any variety which is under the common knowledge, if all are aware about the variety, that will also called extant variety. Or any variety which is, whether it is registered or not, or notified or not, but if it is under the public domain, they are also called extant variety. Another is the basically a farmer variety. The farmer variety, any variety, those are grown by the farmers since a long time. Normally we call it, we can compare with the land races. So since long, very long time, they are adopted variety, local area, or any wild relative or land races, those are farmers are possessing their knowledge and they are utilizing for directly or indirectly that particular land races, wild variety, they are called farmers variety. So for the purpose of registration, these two kinds of varietal mechanism must be there, then only they can be registered. So what are the farmers right under these PPB and FR Act? So farmers right are described under section 39 of this Act. So here farmers have the same privilege as breeder has in PBR. Means farmer, they will be recognized as a breeder, as a curator, as a farmer, and they can register their variety. So as we consider breeder in PBR mechanism, similarly we have to recognize farmers in farmers right. And farmers can also declare that their variety is registrable and they can commercial variety if the variety initially obtained lawfully. Lawful means it is not any taken from any other directly, if they have developed a variety or they know the knowledge of the variety. And the farmers can also save, use, resource, so exchange, share, or sell their farm produce of their protected variety. Similarly, farmers but cannot sell these variety. They can sell variety, but not in any branded name. And farmers can claim damage also under this Act. If any protected variety, seeds of that variety that not gives the appropriate yield potential or as described by the other farmers or breeder, so they can also go for the claim or damage for the claim under their rights. So farmers are also exempted under section 44 that they have not to pay any fee for any proceeding. They have not to pay fee for the field inspection. And similarly, if they wanted to obtain any document from the PPB and FRA authority, so they will get free of cost all the information, all the documents. So no fee has to be paid by the farmers. These are the exemptions. So we must understand the PBR. Without understanding the PBR, we cannot understand actually how it is different. So we all know the PBR are basically the plant breeder rights. Those are given to the owner of a variety that excluding others from producing or commercializing the propagating material minimum for 15 to 20 years. So these rights are given by the state to the originator of variety, or state means the government. So government has to give a right to the breeder or originator of variety for 15 to 20 years. These are the monopoly rights, and only that person can use their rights or they can transfer their rights. So this concept of basically this PBR was started under the UPO, that is International Union for Protection of New Varieties of Plants. The UPO Act 1991, currently it is under applicable. So the first meeting was UPO was organized in 1961. when some rough draft was made for the PVR. Later on, it was divided in 1972. And finally, in 1978, the process of registration of variety under PVR was published. And then again, with some modification, it was published in 1991. So now 1991 Act is applicable. So if we see the comprehensive statement of UPO 1978 and 1991. So earlier under UPO 1978, all the genera of agricultural, horticultural, and botanical importance, they were allowed to register. But now only genera of species, genera or species, those are covered. So earlier, anything, anyone can register. But now only the genera and species, those are cultivated, they are allowed to register. Earlier, there were four parameters, distinctness, three parameters, distinctness, uniformity, and stability. Distinctness means there must be at least single trait that could be identifiable. We can differentiate our variety with the other variety. Uniformity means it must have the morphological uniformity over the field or under the different environmental conditions. And stability means generation after generation, there is no change, there is no genetic drift. So these three parameters were required. They are called DUS. So these three parameters were required for the registration of variety. But in 1991, one more parameter, that is novelty, was included. Here, novelty means the variety is new. And when we say the new means then variety will be called new. If anyone has commercialized the variety before going the registration, then it will not be called new. So this one more parameter is been included. Earlier, only reproductive parts and commercial plant parts were basically allowed. But many people earlier also, they were using whole plant. And so that's why now the whole plant species are discovered under the protection. Now if variety is protected, even no plant part can be utilized by anyone without the consent of the plant breeder. Then the breeders exemptions, under the breeders exemptions, breeders were allowed to do research work in the protected variety without taking any consent from the other breeder or the basically originator or the variety or the PVR holder of the variety. But many breeders, what they started, they have started manipulation in the new developed variety by only changing one or few traits. They have saying that the variety is new and they were registering their variety in the name of new variety. So the original breeder, he was basically suffering due to this manipulation. Then in 1991 Act, even breeders are allowed to do research without taking consent. But if the new breeder is making only one or two changes, then variety will not be called new. It will be called essentially derived variety. And variety will be registered under essential derived variety. And the benefit will be shared by both the breeder, by initial breeder as well as the new breeder. So this one change has been done in 1991 Act. Similarly, in case of farmers' privilege, farmers were also allowed to save the seed of protected variety, but they were not allowed to exchange the seeds from other farmers. But in case of developed country, the farmers are also utilizing the exchanging and commercializing of the seeds. So to overcome this, now it is optional to member state. So now it depends upon the country whether they wanted to give the farmers privilege or not. So under PVR, earlier it was 18 years for the grapevine and other trees and 15 years for other plants. Now this time tenure of the protection has been increased. Now it is 25 years for grapevines and 20 years for other plants. So now we can understand they are very similar. If protection of plant variety and farmers' right and PVR rights quite similar in their nature. So PPB and FR Act was basically initiated or approved or came into enforced in 2001 under the TRIPS, and our country, India, was the first country who has adopted PPB and Plant Farmers Rights Act. Major, already I explained you that here the variety that is developed by the farmers will be protected or will be registered either by the patent or by the sui generis system or by the combination of all. The farmers will be recognized as the breeder, cultivator, and conservator seeds, like we recognize our breeders or scientists. Similarly, it also allows to sell their produce, but not any brand name. And farmers can register their variety by these four parameters already I explained in PBR in my earlier slides. So, but another most important that under the PPB and FR, no variety will be registered those have terminator gene or any gene that can damage the environment or the livelihood of human or animal or plant. So such any variety those are possessing these kind of genes, they are not allowed to register. And duration of protection is 15 years for extant variety. Extant variety, yeah, already I explained. 18 years for varieties of tree and vines for 15 years for other crops. And here also compulsory licensing provision is given. Under the compulsory licensing, basically, if the amount of variety is not that much of available, then it is permissible to start franchises or licensing for the commercialization purpose, basically to make available adequate quantity of seeds at a reasonable price. So the desirable farmer, they can get the seeds of variety. So compulsory licensing is another basically feature that was added in the PPB and FR. And government has also under this act, they have established the plant variety registry. Here plant variety registry means the national register of plant varieties will be maintained by the PPB and FR authority. In national register of plant, the name of the farmers and name of the variety and name of the breeder and relevant details of all the registered variety will be accumulated, and if desired, they can be supplied those who need such information. So PPB and FRA also established National Gene Fund to basically make out the expenses, whatever the expenses to run the authority, this basically taken from National Gene Fund. And National Gene Fund gets money from the commercial plant breeder, those are registering their variety, and annual royalty that is given by the seed companies, and many donations from national international organizations. So in this way, the whatever amount or money is received or collected by the National Gene Fund, it will be, this is normally used to run the authority. And in this authority, there are two basically system. One is PPB and under this act, PPB and FR authority. It has 15 members, 8 members from the central government nominee, 5 members from farmers and tribal women and seed industry, agriculture university, and 2 members on the rotation basis from the different state government nominees. So this is the apex body. I told you that the headquarters of PPB and FR authority in NASCOM campus in New Delhi. And another is Plant Variety Protection Appellate. Plant Variety Protection Appellate Tribunal, they work as a court. If any kind of decision taken by the PPB and FR authority, and if farmer or anyone who think that they have not been given justice, then they can approach to the appellate tribunal. And the tribunal will listen the whole case or dispute as a court, and they will give the decision. And the decision given by the Plant Variety Protection Appellate and Tribunal, it is normally binding in nature. So both the party, all the party, they have to obey of the decision taken by Plant Variety Protection Appellate. So this is the structure of PPB and FRA. Administrative level, it comes under the central government, under the Ministry of Agriculture, but it is independent. We can see that comes under the affiliated with the agriculture university, but not supervised. Only they are supervised by the ministry, not directly. They cannot get the order from the ministry. And there are several committees for this purpose. And one registry is also there. Already explained what is the PPB and FR registry. And tribunal is purely independent. It is work as a court. So under the tribunal, there is no supervision of the government. So they can be independently work. So this is basic about the protection of plant variety. There are several other things also. So I think already time is more than one. So thank you. If any query from any students or anyone, I can share.
Thank you very much, sir, for nice and informative lecture. It was very wonderful. Thank you very much.
Okay, okay. So my video already.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, so thank you to all giving me opportunity again. And I think the next session or anything will be initiated by Dr. S.K. Singh. So I thank Dr. S.K. Singh.
Thank you very much, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you very much, sir. I would like to special thank to you.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. S.S. Gaurav, Chairman, and Dr. Naushad Khan and Mr. Abhishek Singh to give us a valuable time from your busy schedule. And also thankful to Dr. D.V. Singh for his fantastic lead lecture. And also thanks to all the speakers. Special thanks. Again, special thanks to the chairman and co-chairman for timely completion. For timely completion, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you
very much,
thank
sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
We are sabhi participants. I also thanks to all the participants who are engaged in the Zoom as well as live engaged in the YouTube channel, sir.
And a special thank also to you for organizing such a very wonderful event, international thank you, event. Thank you.
Thank you. So thank you to all.
Aap sabhi ka sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.